A year ago today, I was on day 83 of a 100-day experiment attempting to live without petroleum. Around this time, I was probably just finishing up an 8-mile bicycle commute after having a typical breakfast of oatmeal, maple sugar, and taking a chilly 1-gallon bucket shower. This self-inflicted experiment was an attempt on my part to understand an issue that we currently know very little about, and that's peak oil, and translate what I was learning to make sustainable design more relevant. Peak oil is the point at which we reach the maximum extraction potential of petroleum, and it's estimated to have already occurred in 2006. So past this point, petroleum will become increasingly depleted to the point where it actually takes more energy to extract this resource from the earth than it can actually produce itself, making it obsolete. As the most energy-dense resource ever discovered, petroleum has totally reinvented our society to the point where it's difficult to look around the room today and find something that isn't made out of petroleum materials, using petroleum energy, or has been transported using petroleum fuels. To add to this, our use and abuse of this resource has created the sustainability and climate change issues that we face today. As designers and architects, we now know that building operation construction is responsible for 65% of electricity use, 12% of potable water use, and is responsible for 60% of ozone-depleting materials. Because of this, there's been a huge movement in sustainable design to create architecture that can respond to these issues and clean up our own mess. And this movement's really been focused on the operation of buildings, material sourcing, and energy reductions. At the same time, we have a huge surge of interest from businesses, nonprofits, individuals who are looking to make sustainable change in their own lives. And what I'm seeing is that these two movements of sustainable buildings and sustainable lifestyles are really currently very disconnected. When I think about design and behavior, I can't help to think that many, even the smallest details of our built environment really change the way in which we live. And if we think about, you know, if you got rid of a shower drain and you were forced to see how much water you were using and actually stand in it, that would totally change the way in which we use water. So I'm not suggesting we get rid of shower drains, but I think it's easy to see how the design of even these small details changes the way we live and interact with our resources. Part of the reason that this is so difficult right now is that even though petroleum is being depleted rapidly, we're not really seeing the effects of this change yet. And so how do we understand, but how do we design for an issue that is currently sort of invisible to us? So this was the burning question that inspired me to take on a project which I've called 100 Days Without Oil as an attempt to understand in a more tangible way, you know, what this future is going to be like and how do we respond to that as designers. So I began this project by basically taking a close and conscious look at my life and creating a list of where I came across petroleum directly or indirectly in all aspects of my life. And from this list, I created sort of a set of criteria or rules for myself. Eat only local organic foods, transport myself only using my own energy, create no waste, and use only a limited amount of water and electricity. I realized going through this project that I was really looking at, I was really experiencing sustainable infrastructure and sustainable lifestyles in three different lenses. So first, I was sort of educating myself with research of the issues as I came across them. I was experiencing these things in my own life. And I also had the opportunity to take a look at what things I could do as an individual, but what things really needed to change on a larger infrastructure and policy scale. So I think by sort of looking back on my experience of these 100 days through these three different lenses can shed some valuable light on how I was literally acting my way into a new way of thinking. So because I could only eat local food during this project, I first had to have a pretty clear understanding of what local food was available to me and what does eating local really even mean. I began by basically mapping out all the foods that were labeled as local that I was using at my co-op, and I found that many of these products were actually coming from like a 300 or 400 mile radius, and I really wanted to narrow that down to about a 100 mile radius. The reality of not being able to grab a sandwich for lunch, I couldn't eat anything that came in any kind of packaging, and nothing pre-made gave me a totally different understanding of what eat local in our society right now means. So, because of our short growing season in Minnesota, I learned to can, dehydrate, and freeze foods to preserve them as the growing season came to an end. And I lived off of this preserved supply of food for the last month of the project just to see what this is really like. I even experimented with growing food indoors in my living room as kind of a last-ditch effort to have a fresh local food supply as the growing season came to a close. I realized pretty quickly the shortcomings of our local food infrastructure as I spent countless hours in the kitchen cooking foods from scratch local ingredients that I could find in bulk. But you know, in the end, all this food was incredibly fresh and healthy, and it's something that I've continued to do today to buy bulk local ingredients. I faced very different challenges when it came to water. Because all water has to be transported and cleaned using petroleum fuels, my goal was basically to use only the amount of water which I could hypothetically capture on my roof as rainwater. And so it hypothetically wouldn't need this infrastructure and energy to transport and clean it. So this average amount, which I divided by the residents that were living in my building, ended up being about 15 gallons of water. And tracking my use before the project, I realized that I was using about 54 gallons of water on an average day, so I was going to have to limit this use to less than 30% of the water that I typically use. So the physicality of actually filling a 15-gallon rain barrel every morning, as it became sort of a ritual, and pumping it into these various buckets to be used for showering, for dishes, whatever water uses I needed, gave me a sense of sort of the visual and physical sense of how much water I was using, how much water I needed to use, and haul around the house for all these different uses. I also realized that there were really three big water uses that contributed to most of my consumption, and they were clothes washing, flushing the toilet, and taking a shower. So by focusing on changing just these three aspects, hand washing all my laundry, reducing toilet flushes, and taking 1 to 5 gallon bucket showers, I could pretty easily stay within this 15-gallon water budget without having to worry every time, you know, I needed water for some little task. My experiences with waste were actually pretty similar to water in many ways. Because all waste has to be transported, even recyclables, using petroleum fuels, my goal is basically create no waste, if at all possible. And in the same way that our water use has become sort of invisible to us, how much waste we create is also sufficiently disguised by our current infrastructures. I took an inventory of the amount of waste what kinds of waste and the amount that I created in a typical week, and found that a majority of my waste was food packaging, which I was able to eliminate by buying all of my food in bulk in reusable jars and mason jars. Food scraps, which are typically just thrown in the trash or down a garbage disposal, were turned into nutrients in a worm composting bin in my kitchen. And I was also able to eliminate recyclables by using refillable and reusable containers, such as those you can get for milk or refillable egg cartons. And in the end, after trying to create no waste for 100 days, I was left with about a half a paper bag full of actual waste and then some recyclables. And a huge part of why this was possible for me was just having access to bulk foods and reusable and refillable container options. The experience of transporting myself using only my own energy is a great example of sort of the value of learning through experience. If my criteria for this action had been bike, you know, as much as possible, I likely would have quit biking as soon as it got cold, you know, whenever I was running late, or whenever it was inconvenient, which could have been pretty much all the time. So instead, you know, because I was required to bike, despite the circumstances, I actually found that it was, I actually preferred it to driving in most cases once I'd gotten used to it. So the ability to get outside and use my body every morning gave me energy instead of making me feel groggy. And it was actually a stress reliever instead of a stress creator, as driving had often been for me. Being able to watch the sun come up while riding on a bike path instead of sitting in traffic became something that I really valued, which was surprising to me, being that this was an action that I was really sort of dreading doing in this project. Again, the infrastructures that were available to me, this is bike paths in Minneapolis, played a huge part in how well I was able to accomplish this action. So with energy, it was basically the opposite side of the spectrum as far as infrastructures that supported, and it revealed a huge need for infrastructure change in our societies. Energy was in a similar fashion to water. It had sort of an electricity budget that was calculated from the amount of solar energy that I could potentially have captured on my roof. And from this, to reduce this energy, I changed the schedule of my day, so I was waking up with the sun and I could maximize the amount of time that I could work during daylight and not turn lights on. And between that and eliminating electrical appliances that I didn't really need, which we have a lot of in our kitchens, I was pretty easily able to stay within my energy budget until the heat came on. Heat accounts for about 40% of all of our home energy use across the nation. And so in Minnesota, in a really cold climate, that's a much huger chunk. And I found that I was actually exceeding my energy budget by about 10 times with the space heating. And it reveals a huge infrastructure and policy change that's needed. So to summarize, I'd taken an issue that is a daunting and seemingly impossible issue, and I'd just broken it down into a set of actions to make it a more manageable issue. As authors Chip and Dan Heath of the book Switch explain, big problems are rarely solved with commensurately big solutions. Instead, they're most often solved with a sequence of smaller solutions, sometimes over weeks and sometimes over decades. And you know, many people, when faced with these seemingly impossible tasks, just shut down with lack of direction. But by breaking these things down into more manageable and measurable components, we can create greater clarity with this problem. And it's quite a bit easier for us as human beings to deal with this stuff. I realized going through this project that I was learning about the things that I could do as an individual, but I was also coming across all these other issues of things that I can't change this myself. I really need larger design, policy, and infrastructure changes to make this possible. So the project that I'm working on right now is called the Three Actions Project. And it's a collaboration of design and public policy, which basically focuses on creating a forum of combining people's understandings and experiences living sustainable lifestyles and how those things can affect our design solutions. Participants in this project will choose three actions from a list of 50, which they're personally interested in, and they'll commit to changing those things for 3 months of their life. Goals of this project are, first, to connect people to information and experts to further their knowledge of sustainable design. And then, second, provide experiences like I had during my 100 Days Without Oil project to actually commit to changing these things in their life for 3 months. And third, to create basically a body of shared knowledge of how these experiences, people are successful or unsuccessful with them in their lifestyles, depending on where they live and what their values are. In this way, there's no experience that isn't valuable. You know, if somebody takes on an action and they can't do it, it's important to document why that was a struggle for them and why they couldn't do it. And in the same way, people who are successful with doing these things, we want to know why they were successful and what was it about that action that allowed you to successfully complete that. Design has the opportunity to use projects like the Three Actions Project to help inform design, but if we look around us, this information is really surrounding us. If you think about, you know, one glance around our communities, we can see the number of people who've already taken an initiative in their lives to operate at a more sustainable level. And you know, the number of blogs that people have dedicated to sustainable living is just further proof of a huge thirst for this kind of information for people. Design can not only use this information, we actually need this information. And the challenge is really, how do we create a meaningful forum for engaging with these experiences? In this sense, what we really need to do is create sustainable environments that foster an awareness for people and empower them to make individual change in their own lives as we move into the future. And I'll end there. Thank you.